أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. My dear respected brothers and elders, mothers and sisters, all praise is due to Allah تبارك وتعالى who has favored us with Islam. We thank Allah Azza wa Jal for granting us this opportunity to fulfill the obligation of Jumu'ah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that inshaAllah through this Jumu'ah that we increase in Iman. That we leave the Slax Creek Masjid with our iman strong and our love for Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam at another level. Say Ameen, brothers. Ameen. Today, inshallah, I would like to speak about a beautiful story about a great alim by the name of Hatim al-Asam. Hatim al-Asam was a great scholar from the Tabi'een. Now who are the Tabi'een? The Tabi'een are the predecessors, those who had Iman and they lived in the time of the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum ajma'een. And as we know, the Sahaba are those who were Muslim and they witnessed or they were in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Hatim al-Asam, Allah Azza wa Jal blessed him with great knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him great wisdom. So Hatim al-Asam, he studied for 33 years under his famous ustad, teacher, by the name of Ash-Shaqiq al-Balkhi. These are two great scholars of deen, ulama of the past. So after many years of Imam Hatim serving his community, he decides to pay his ustad a visit. So he greets his ustad, and then his ustad replies by saying, Wa alaykum salam. He then mentions, Kayfa ahwalun nas? How is the condition of your people? He said, Alhamdulillah, in u'tu shakaru wa in ibturu sabaru. That when we are given something, we are grateful. And when we are tested by Allah, we have sabr. So Ash-Shaqiq al-Balkhi, he looks at him and he says, this is nothing special. He says, Hadha halul kilabi indana. He says, you know what? Even the dogs do that. You give a dog a bone, he'll be happy. And if you delay that bone, the dog will be patient. So Shaqiq al-Balkhi, he says something amazing. He says, نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ إِنْ أُعْطِينَا صَبَرْنَا وَإِذِ ابْتُلِينَا شَكَرْنَا. Subhanallah. He says, we are a nation that when we are given something, we should have patience. And when we are tested by Allah, we should say, Alhamdulillah. When you went through hardship, maybe you got very sick or something bad really happened to you. Did you ever say Alhamdulillah? Did you ever say, Ya Allah, this is from you and I accept this from you? Did we ever approach this? Did we ever approach our hardship in a positive way, subhanallah? And this was the trend of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. They did not take examination, hardship as a punishment from Allah, but they took it as an opportunity to draw nearer to the mercy of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So Ash-Shaqiq al-Balkhi, Shaykh Shaqiq al-Balkhi, he then says to his student, Ya Hatim, kam makatha ma'i? How many years did you remain in my suhba? Meaning, how many years did you study with me? He says, makathtu ma'aka thalathan wa thalathina sana. I remained as your student in your companionship for 33 years. He says, ماذا تعلمت مني? What did you learn from me during this period of 33 years? He says, والله يا شيخ, ما تعلمت منك إلا ثماني مسائل. I did not learn anything from you except 8 things. How many things?
8.
So the sheikh, you know, imagine, you're not talking about 5-6 years, 33 years. That's a long time, man. That's a long time. He says, what? The sheikh is now worried. I gave you all my life. يعني أمضيت عمري معك. You took my whole life. And you are telling me today that you only learn 8 things. He says, Wallahi ya Shaykh, I cannot lie. I have only learned 8 things from you. So now the Shaykh is confused. He says, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. From Allah we come and to Allah is our return. Tayyib, tell me, what are these 8 things? Now my dear brothers, subhanallah, it is amazing that this Shaykh, Hatim al-Asam, one of the tabi'een, he mentioned this and these 8 things have been documented. So what I'm about to share with you, inshallah, in this Jumu'ah khutbah, I want everyone to take heed. And I want everyone, inshallah ta'ala, to ponder over every mas'ala, everything that we, inshallah ta'ala, are going to speak about during this khutbah. So remember, inshallah, I want you all to take home these 8 masail. And inshallah ta'ala, we are now extracting knowledge of a great alim from the tabi'een. His consensus of 33 years in 8 pointers. How many points? 8 points, inshallah. Tayyib, awwalu shay, the first thing. He says, Inni nadartu ila al-khalq. وَوَجَدْتُ أَنَّ كَثِيرًا مِّنْهُمْ يُحِبُّ مَحْبُوبٌ فَإِذَا ذَهَبَ إِلَى الْقَبْرِ ذَهَبَ وَتَرَكَ مَحْبُوبٌ. He says, after pondering over the creation, my society, I found many people. They were very connected to their beloved things. This one connected to his house. This one to his mode of transportation. This one connected to his wealth. This one connected to his mahbub, these beloved things. But he says the same person who was so connected to these beloved things that we have, family, wealth, etc., etc. فَإِذَا ذَهَبَ إِلَى الْقَبْرِ, when he goes to the graveyard, ذَهَبَ, he goes, وَتَرَكَ مَحْبُوبٌ, and he leaves behind all of these beloved things. We have a computer, we have our family, we have so many things that are mahbub, they are beloved to us, but we have to leave them behind. He then says, I reflected over the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يَتْبَعُ الْمَيِّتَ ثَلَاثَ. 3 things follow a person to the grave. أَهْلُهُ وَمَالُهُ وَعَمَلُ. A person's family, his wealth and good and bad deeds. فَيَرْجِعُ اثنين. 2 things return back. A person's family, a person's wealth. All of those beloved things, they remain behind. And the only thing that will remain with us in our qabr is our good deeds. What is it? Our good deeds. So Hatim al-Asam, he says, the first thing I learned, one of the most important things in my life after spending 33 years with my Shaykh, he says, فَجَعَلْتُ حَسَنَاتِ مَحْبُوبِي. I made the most beloved thing to me doing good deeds. فَإِذَا ذَهَبْتُ إِلَى الْقَبْرِ كَانَتْ مَعِي. So that when I go to the graveyard, my good deeds are with me. Subhanallah. This is the first thing I want everyone to digest. That inshallah, if we make our good deeds the most beloved thing to us, we will go out of our way to do good deeds. As a result, our good deeds will protect us and grant us victory in the qabr and on the day of qiyamah when we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So inshallah, make your good deeds after Allah and His Rasul the most beloved thing to you inshallah, so that inshallah you will perform much more of them. Because if you love something, you want to do it more often. True. If you have an habit that you love, something that you love doing so much, so if you develop a love for doing good deeds, inshallah your good deeds will increase, and inshallah those good deeds will be with you in the qabr, inshallah. May Allah Azza wa Jal grant us the understanding. That's number one. Thaniyan, the second thing he says, Inni nadartu ila al-khalq. Inni nadartu ila qawli Allah ta'ala. Wa amma man khafa maqama rabbih. وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى فَعَلِمْتُ أَنَّ قَوْلَهُ تَعَالَى هُوَ الْحَقِّ فَأَجْهَدْتُ نَفْسِي عَنِ الدَّفْعِ الْهَوَى حَتَّى اسْتِقَرَّتْ عَلَى طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ. He says, after pondering over an ayah of the Quran where Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. As for the one who fears He's standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the day of Qiyamah, we will all stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. This person, when he is tempted by the shaitan, a person is about to fall into zina or do something haram, this person, he remembers the day that he will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. This person, he protects his private parts. This person, he turns away from the plot of shaitan. Allah ta'ala says, for such a person, فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. For that person who can control his nafs, he can control his nafs against the plot of shaitan. Allah ta'ala says, فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. That for such a person, his abode will be Jannah. His abode will be Jannah. So he says, after pondering over this ayah of the Quran, he says, after pondering over this ayah of the Quran, I strive with all my might to prevent myself from falling into the deceptions of shaitan. And I went out of my way to ensure that every move that I make is such that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with me, subhanAllah. That I obey the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the second thing. That when we are put in a situation, always remember the day that we will stand in front of Allah. And remember that when you are tempted by the plot of shaitan, whatever sin it may be, remember that your reward for refraining from that which Allah has prohibited, Allah Azza wa Jal will grant you Jannah inshaAllah. Allahumma ja'alna minhum min ahli al-Jannah inshaAllah. Thalithan, the third thing that Hatim al-Asam learned from his ustad al-Shaqiq al-Balkhi, being in his suhbah for 33 years. He says, inni nadhartu ila al-khalq wa wajadtu anna kathiran minhum يتباهى بماله وحسبه ونسبه ونذرت إلى قول الله تعالى ما عندكم ينفد وما عند الله باق. He says, after pondering over the creation of Allah, my society, I found many people boasting about their wealth, boasting about their status, boasting about their family lineage. I then reflected over the words of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, where Allah Ta'ala says, مَا عِنْدَكُمْ يَنْفَدُ وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَاقٍ. Whatever we have will perish, but whatever we leave with Allah is everlasting. Meaning whatever good deeds you perform, whatever sadaqah you have given, you have invested that with Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So what did Hatim al-Asam say after pondering over this ayah of the Quran? He says, فَكُلَّمَا وَقَعَ فِي يَدِهِ شَيْءٌ لَهُ قِيمَةٌ وَجَّهْتُهُ لِلَّهِ لِيَحْفَظَهُ لِي. He says, every time I placed my hand on something of value, I entrusted it to Allah to protect for me, subhanAllah. Look at that. Every time I place my hand on something of value, I entrusted it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect for me. So what was the ayah? مَا عِنْدَكُمْ يَنْفَدُ وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَاقٍ. Whatever we have will perish, but whatever we leave with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, it is everlasting. That is number three, right? So these are the, inshallah, the eight masail that inshallah, if we are to follow them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us the ultimate success of this dunya and akhirah, insha'Allah. Rabi'an, the fourth thing. He says, إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ إِلَى الْخَلْقِ فَرَأَيْتُ كُلَّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَرْجِعُ إِلَى الْمَالِ وَالشَّرَفِ وَالنَّسَبِ فَنَذَرْتُ إِلَى قَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ فَعَلِمْتُ فِي التَّقْوَى حَتَّى أَكُونَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ كَرِيمًا. Allahu Akbar. Look at this amazing point. He says, the fourth thing I learned from my sheikh, being in his suhbah for 33 years, my dear brothers and sisters. He says, I pondered over the creation. I observe, think that their dignity and honor lie in the multitude of family and large clans. They were fascinated by these two things. Others claimed honor and dignity in abundance of wealth and in children. And they were proud of it. Some believed honor and power abide in appropriating the wealth of others, doing injustice to them, shedding their blood. And others considered dignity to consist of extravagance and spending wealth in a foolish manner. I meditated over the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah says, "Inna akramakum inda Allahi atqakum," that yani the most honorable and righteous in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those who adopt piety and who are conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says, I convince myself that the Quran, it is haqq. That the Quran, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is the truth. And I have dedicated my life to ensure that I become a slave that is most righteous in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what counts. What Allah azza wa jal thinks of me, and what am I doing to attain that taqwa? The most honored in the eyes of Allah is not the one who has the greatest wealth, or who can sign the biggest bank check, or who has the fanciest car or house, no. Or if you are Arab or Ajam, no. Inna akramakum inda Allah, the most honored in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who has the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who is pious, the one who has that beautiful relationship with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. That is number four. Number five, khamisan, inni nadartu ila hadha al-khalq. وهم يطعن بعضهم في بعض ويلعن بعضهم بعضا والأصل في هذا كله حسد ثم نظرت إلى قول الله تعالى نحن قسمنا بينهم معيشتهم في الحياة الدنيا ورفعنا بعضهم فوق بعض درجات. He says فتركت الحسد واجتنبوا الحق وعلمت أن القسمة عند الله فتركت عداوة الخلق عني. He says, the fifth thing I learned from my sheikh, being in his suhba for 33 years, I found many people showing hatred towards one another. People slandering one another. I found many people oppressing one another. And he says, the basis of all of this hatred is hasad, is jealousy. And we all know the dangers of jealousy. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Inna al-hasada ya'kulu al-hasanat." That jealousy, it eats up good deeds like how fire eats up wood. And we know also the Prophet of Allah said, "La yajtami'u fi jawfi 'abdin al-iman wal-hasad." There are two qualities that cannot exist in a human at the same time, and that is being jealous and having iman. If you are jealous, if you have hasad, the haram hasad, your iman is gone. Subhanallah. So it's very important, my dear brothers. He then says, I found people who were jealous of other people's fortune. We live in this time. People can't wish well for others. But then he reflected over the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, نَحْنُ قَسَمْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ مَعِيشَتَهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. That it is Allah. He is the one who decides the rizq for insan. وَرَفَعْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ فَوْقَ بَعْضٍ دَرَجَاتٍ. Allah has divided the rizq. Some people have more than others. This is the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are unhappy with someone else's fortune, what you are actually saying, you are saying, Ya Allah, I am not happy with your qadr. I am not happy with the decree of Allah. Astaghfirullah. You are not happy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one who divides the rizq. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who decides who will be more wealthy than others. So after pondering over this ayah of the Quran, he says that I left all forms of hasad. And I left my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one who sustains us. Number six, very, very quickly, because I only have 3 minutes left. He says, إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ إِلَى الْخَلْقِ فَرَأَيْتُ وَاحِدٌ مِّنْهُمْ يَطْلَبُ كَسْرَةُ الْخُبْزِ فَيَذِلُّ بِهَا نَفْسَهُ ويدخل فيها ما لا يحل له ثم نظرت إلى قول الله تعالى وما من دابة في الأرض إلا على الله رزقها. He says, I looked at the creation and I saw people asking for a piece of bread. And they were people who were humiliating themselves, and they were entering into transactions and that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram just to attain some rizq. I then reflected over the words of Allah, where Allah ta'ala says, وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا, that no creature roams the surface of the earth except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides its rizq. Except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides his rizq. So Hatim al-Asam said that I am also of the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fulfill my rizq, so I have nothing to worry about, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises if he can feed the ants and the birds and the trees, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can also feed me and you, subhanallah. So how important is it for us to put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look after us. The last point, thaminan. He says, إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ إِلَى الْخَلْقِ فَرَأَيْتُ مِنْهُمْ مُتَوَكِّلُونَ عَلَى الْمَخْلُوقِ. He says, I pondered over the creation and I found people placing their reliance not in Allah. They were placing their reliance on the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This one, he is placing his reliance, يعني على العقار, على التجارة, يعني على الصناعة. This one, he is placing his reliance on his wealth. This one, he is placing his reliance on his health. This one, he is placing his reliance on his business. He then says, I reflected over the words of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, where Allah ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. Whoever places his reliance in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient. Wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters, we limit the power of Allah. We forget that everything, nothing can happen without the permission of Allah. Sahih? Can a leaf fall from the tree without the permission of Allah? La. Can we move a muscle without Allah? La. Mustahil. It is impossible. So he then says, after reflecting over the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, Wallahi, from that day onwards, I place my full reliance in Allah. وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. Whoever places their reliance in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient. I will end off with one narration. Hafiz Abu Na'im reports that a man asked Hatim al-Asam, he says, on which things have you built your trust? Because Hatim al-Asam, this great alim, he was known to be one of the scholars of deen who put his reliance in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was such a wise scholar of deen. So he says, Hatim replied on four qualities. I learned that my sustenance will not be taken by another person. So I'm at peace with that. And I learned that my work will not be done by anyone. So I kept busy at it. And I learned that death comes suddenly. So I'm hastening to prepare for it. And I learned that do not escape from Allah's sight. So I keep shy of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. My dear respected brothers and elders, mothers and sisters, these are eight masail. Imagine this great alim. If we are to live a life by these eight masail from the Quran and the Sunnah teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this will result in our success in this dunya. What type of success? Inshallah, the ultimate success of this dunya. And inshallah the qabr, and when we stand in front of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, may Allah grant us firm iman. May Allah azza wa jal make us of those people who take heed and implement these eight masail from Quran and Sunnah within our lives. Bifadlillahi ta'ala. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayhi.